Hi everyone. So for this discussion, we will be looking into chapter 2 of your module, right? That is the meaning and nature of the state. So I will be discussing the definition of the state, elements of the state, and theories on the origin of the state, including the functions or objectives, and powers of the state. Okay, so class, these are basic concepts, okay, that you should be knowing by heart, right? So because you will be needing these concepts or using this information as you go on in your study of political science, okay? Okay, so let's take a look at the definition of the state, okay? So there are different political scientists or scholars who have defined the state, okay? And they defined it differently. However, I'd like us to look into the most recognized definition of the state. Okay, this is by Garner, right? So for him, the state is a community of persons more or less numerous, permanently occupying a definite portion of a territory, independent of external control, and possessing an organized government to which the great body of inhabitants render habitual obedience. Okay, so I'd like us to take a look on this definition. What is present? What makes a state from this definition? Okay, so first, there is a community of persons. There are people. Okay, there are numerous people, and these people are occupying a territory. Okay, and they are independent. They're independent of external control, meaning they have their own ways, okay? Nobody is dictating upon them, right? And they possess an organized government, right? So there are people, there's a territory, they're independent, they cannot be dictated upon by external factors. So that's what you call sovereignty, okay? They have a government, and these people render obedience to the government. All right, so from that definition, it's evident that the state have elements, okay? What are the elements of the state? What are the components of the state from that definition, okay? So a state have people, territory, government, and sovereignty. Okay, so those are four elements or four components of the state, without one of them, okay, missing, or with one of them missing, there would be no state. Okay, let's take a look at the first element of the state, people. Okay, so when we say people, these are inhabitants or the population of a state. These are individuals living in the state, okay? And of course, these are citizens who have rights and duties that are legally recognized. So they are individuals living in the state. They have rights that the government should protect, and they also have obligations to perform for the government. So in the absence of people, class, any organization will not exist. So without people, okay, there will be no state. Next, territory. So it consists of the land within the boundaries of the state, the airspace above that land, the inland waters, so the bodies of waters within the territory, like rivers, springs, okay? This also includes natural resources within the territory, and the 12 miles of the sea beyond the state's coastlines. So from our coastlines, 12 miles beyond that, it's still part of our territory, okay? So territory, class, is an indispensable or essential element of a state. Without a territory, a group of people cannot claim that they are a state, okay? They cannot declare that they have a state if they don't have a recognized territory to declare as their own, okay? An ethnical group of people that's seeking a homeland or a territory to settle in permanently is the Palestinian people, okay? They're a numerous group of people, but they cannot declare that they have a state. They cannot lay claim to statehood because they don't have a territory. Okay, so if you know their history, okay, Israel and the Palestinian people are in conflict. Okay, naunahan sila ng Israel. Okay, when Israel declared independence, they have outlined their territory. Okay, and apparently, okay, walang natira sa for these Palestinians. So they are claiming that they own a portion of Israel. However, of course, they cannot already declare themselves as a state since Israel already declared that territory as their own. Okay. Likewise, our insurgents, our communist insurgents in the Philippines, like our NPAs, the group of people that's wanting to be separated from the Philippines, they do not enjoy the status of a state. Okay, because they don't have a territory which they can declare as their own, because the Philippines already, okay, owned the land. Okay, unless of course they succeed in bringing a portion of the Philippine territory under their control, but that's not happening. Okay, where our government is always working, okay, to defend our territory and to defeat these insurgents, right? Okay, third, government. It is an instrument or machinery of the state that carries out its will, purposes, and objectives. So the state functions through the government, okay? It's the government that carries out the functions of the state. Okay, so the government class is not similar to the state, right? So, a government is composed of institutions, agencies, and personnel that carry out functions such as law and order, defense, okay, justice, social services, right? So, the state class comprises the entire body of people, okay, within the territory. The state comprises the entire population in the territory, while the government consists only of people within the political community. It consists of people rendering public service. That's why we call them government employees. Okay, so the state, it comprises all the people in the territory. The government comprises the people who are rendering public service. Okay. So, a government class may also change, okay, or be completely abolished, but a state is always permanent as long as it retains the four elements of the state, okay? It cannot be abolished. It's permanent. While a government may change, like, let's say, for example, we shift to a parliamentary government or a federal government from a Republican government. So, pwede siyang mapalitan. Pwede rin siyang mabago. Pwede rin siyang mawala. But the state class, it is permanent as long as it continues to embody the four elements of the state. Okay? Fourth, sovereignty. It is defined as the supreme and final legal authority of the state to enforce its will on its members by coercive sanctions if necessary, which must not be subject to any other power. Okay, so sovereignty class is the supreme authority of the state over its people. Okay, a country cannot be called a state if it does not have sovereignty, if it does not have authority over its people. Okay, so as a citizen, you are obeying the state because the state have sovereignty, because the state have supreme authority over you as the citizen. Okay, so the state can compel the obedience, or the state can demand obedience or participation from the citizens through the exercise of sovereignty. Okay, through the exercise of supreme authority. Right? How? Okay, how can the state exercise sovereignty over you? Okay, there is what we call legitimate force. When it legislates enforced laws and policies, okay, you are bound to follow. Because if you don't, you will go to jail. Okay? That's just an example of the state exercising sovereignty or exercising supreme authority over you as a citizen. Right? So, in the operation of sovereignty, class, in when the state exercises supreme authority over its people, no external body or no other country can, like, meddle. Okay? Hindi pwede makialam ang ibang bansa. Okay? When you exercise your authority over your people. That's why when we enforce laws within the Philippines, okay, other states cannot dictate upon us, cannot say, stop, do not legislate that law. Okay? Because we have sovereignty over our own people and they don't have sovereignty over our own people. Okay? So, it is not subject to any other power. Siya yung pinakamataas na authority, okay, within a territory. That's what you call sovereignty. Let's say, for example, the case of the jailed Senator Leyla Tilima. Okay, right, there was a time when the U.S. government officials demanded the release of Leyla Tilima from prison. Okay, right, so they went to the extent of banning Filipino government officials who were involved or who participated in the imprisonment of Leyla Tilima. Okay, and when they were demanding the release of Leyla Tilima, our Filipino government officials were saying that these government officials, U.S. government officials, cannot just meddle. Okay, they cannot just interfere in the domestic affairs of the country, in the domestic affairs of the Philippines, because what? We have laws. Okay. We have laws that will settle this, okay, that will decide the fate of Leyla Tilima, okay? So we have authority over our own people, okay? We have authority over Leyla Tilima and it's not the US government officials who will have authority over our own people. So that's an example of sovereignty. It cannot be subject to any external power, okay? So we can choose not to honor this. Although, of course, in international relations, the U.S. government or any other government can pressure the Philippines. Okay, but because of sovereignty, we can choose not to listen to them. Okay, because we have authority over our own people. We have our laws. Okay, that will decide for us. All right. There are two aspects, class, of sovereignty. We have what you call internal and external sovereignty. So, internal sovereignty would refer to the absolute power of a state to enforce its will on the people within its territory. Okay? It implies that the state, through the government, possesses powers to control and regulate the conduct or the behavior or the affairs of the people within the borders of the state. Okay, so internal sovereignty again is the supreme authority of the state over the people within its territory. Okay, so you control, you possess the power over your own people. That's internal sovereignty. We say external sovereignty when there is independence of a state from control by any other state. Okay, so that is state independence. You are not controlled by other state. Okay, so external sovereignty should be recognized and respected by other states. Okay, other states should recognize another state as their co-equal. Okay, they should respect the other state and not meddle and not interfere in the domestic affair of the state, not dictate. Okay, of course they can pressure, but they cannot directly interfere into the domestic affairs or national affairs of the other state. Okay, so internal sovereignty, class, This is a relationship between the state and the people, the state and its community. External is a relationship between between a sovereign state and another state. Okay, it's a state-to-state relationship, right? Let's take a look at the attributes of external sovereignty, okay, or state independence, right? So, first, territorial integrity, okay? So, the right of a state to resist, reject any aggression, invasion, or intervention in its affairs from outside of its territorial boundaries. That's what you call territorial integrity. So, under the principle of external sovereignty, you have territorial integrity. You have the right to resist or reject, okay, any invasion, any intervention from other, okay, other states, from outside of your boundaries, okay? So that's why when a country is of course attacking you based on the principle of territorial integrity, you have the right to resist, okay, that attack or that invasion, right? Next, territorial supremacy. So the state has the legal authority and power to impose what it wants to all its people. Could be individuals, groups, or organizations, okay, without interference from any other foreign power. That's what you call territorial supremacy. You are supreme over your territory. You are supreme. You have the legal authority over individuals, over associations or organizations that are created within your territory. Okay, so no other foreign power should exercise supreme authority over them. Okay, so this concept of external sovereignty class was influenced by Niccolo Machiavelli. So he is the father of modern political theory. Okay, so in his book, The Prince, he made recommendations suggesting that a ruler or a government should be free from control by the church as an organization. Okay, so at that time, the Pope was very powerful. Okay, they have control over governments. Okay, they have sovereignty over rulers. And it was Machiavelli who said that the state should be supreme over the church. Okay, although he's not the first, all right, but he was one of the advocate of state supremacy or territorial supremacy. Okay, and because of course the church is it's a religious concept while the state is a political concept, right? Okay. Let's go to theories of the origin of the state. Okay, so there are many political scholars, philosophers who attempted to discover the origin of the state, and this resulted to many theories. Okay, however, I would like us to focus on four theories. All right. First is the theory of divine origin or the divine right theory. So this theory declares that the state was directly created and organized by God. Since God created the state, he appointed rulers or kings over the state. They are agents of God. And because they are agents of God, the people cannot question the ruler, okay? Cannot question the king even if he makes mistake, because the kings and the rulers are only accountable to God. Right? So there is no thing on earth that could limit the will or restrict the power of the rulers. They have absolute power over the people. Okay? They are only accountable to the power of, they are only accountable to God. Okay? Right? According to King James I of England, kings are justly called gods, for they exercise a manner of resemblance of divine power on earth. Kings are accountable to God above only. Okay, so the people cannot question him for the right or wrong done by him. So, in this sense, kings are the images of God upon on earth. Okay? So, even if the kings are wicked, the subject or the people have no right to rebel against him. Okay? It's like to rebel against the king is to rebel against God. Okay? For they are God's chosen vassal. So, walang authority or walang karapatan, right, ang mga tao to rebel against the rulers who were appointed by God. So, that was according to the divine right theory. The state is created by God. God appointed rulers over the state. And the people are under the power of the ruler. They cannot rebel against the rulers. Okay? Second, we have the social contract theory. So, we have three philosophers who are famous on their social contract theory on the origin of the state. Okay? We have Thomas Hobbes, John Locke, and Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Let's first take a look at the social contract theory of Thomas Hobbes. Okay, so for Thomas Hobbes, the nature of man is despicable, nasty, and brutish. So for him, this is the nature of man. When we say despicable, wicked, okay, nasty or horrible, man is dreadful. We say brutish, man is cruel. Okay, so the nature of man for Thomas Hobbes is negative, okay, and they live in a state of nature. What is the state of nature? Okay, man live together without anyone to enforce peace and order and settle conflicts. So, man who is naturally aggressive lives in a situation where there is no peace, there is no order, there is always conflicts. So, the state of nature class, according to Thomas Hobbes, is a situation where it's like a jungle. The stronger animals would devour the weaker ones. There is might makes right in this situation. Okay, so man's desire for self-preservation, order, and peace could be attained only if they surrender all their natural rights and submit their will to an absolute sovereign monarch, which is called the Great Leviathan or the Mortal God. Okay, so to make life bearable, in order for them to live, man created government and ultimately the state. So because of the desire to have order, to preserve their lives, man got together and entered into a contract among themselves to vest authority or sovereignty to a ruler because it was necessary. Okay, it was necessary to bring order out of the chaos in which they lived. So they surrendered their right and will to the great Leviathan, who will exercise sovereignty over them. Okay, and when they surrendered their right and their will to the great Leviathan, in return, the Leviathan would preserve the peace and give his people the security that they needed. However, the power of the monarch or the power of the Leviathan is absolute. Okay, the people had no right to revolt. And but accordingly, it was necessary to bring order out of the chaos, okay, out of the state of nature. Okay, so for John Locke also, men are by nature free, equal, and rational. So this is a positive characteristic or a positive nature of man. Okay, so and men being free, equal, and rational also live in a state of nature where they have a peaceful, natural life. Okay, so unlike the state of nature of Thomas Hobbes where there is chaos, the state of nature for John Locke is peaceful. For Thomas Hobbes, the nature of man is brutish. Okay, man is despicable. For John Locke, man is rational. Okay, so they are in contrast in that aspect. So, however, men still need the state to maintain peace and order according to John Locke. Okay, because they still need essential services. They still need a body or a ruler or a government to settle their quarrels and conflicts. Okay, because man is a social being, you cannot avoid quarrels and conflicts. So they still entered into a contract and gave sovereignty or authority to a ruler to rule over them. However, the people reserved the right to dethrone the king or the government if the government fails to safeguard the security of the people. So if the king in that instance fails to function to secure the people, he can be dethroned, he can be removed, unlike the social contract theory of Hobbes, where the great Leviathan have supreme authority and the people do not have authority, they do not have the right to revolt. So this is opposite. Okay, they are opposite. John Locke and Thomas Hobbes, social contract. How about the social contract theory of Rousseau? Okay, for Rousseau, man by nature was free and happy. Okay, man in the state of nature were innocent, honest, and noble. And they got together and agreed upon a contract to establish the state. Okay, so government is still necessary for Rousseau because men are not equal in energy and intelligence. So in this case, man established the government and the state for the advantage of all. Okay, so individuals got together, they agreed to surrender their will and a part of their freedom to the general will. Okay, it's the will of the majority. Okay, and the general will or the will of the majority would provide security, stability, and better life to individuals. Okay, so in this scenario, an individual is not surrendering his right to a ruler only or to one person only. It is surrendering its right to the will, to the majority. Okay, to the will of the majority, or what you call the general will. In this case, majority wins. So an individual will surrender his will to the will of the majority. Okay, and whatever is the will of the majority, the collective will of the majority, that's what will be followed. Okay, and Rousseau said that whoever refuses to obey the general will shall be compelled to obey by the whole body. Okay, if there is only one person who is against the will of the majority, he shall be compelled to follow the general will. Okay, he will still follow even if he does not really like it. Right? The government in this case, class, is an agent with delegated powers which can be withdrawn or altered as the general will of the people dictated. Okay, so the government can be overthrown by the general will of the people. If the majority says that the government should be changed, it will be changed. Okay, so the government, the function of the government is just to execute the will of the majority. So that's the social contract theory. How about the force theory? Okay. So for the force theory, the nature of man is quarrelsome. Man lusts for power. Man is a social animal. Okay. And the continuous existence of the state demands the enforcement of force. Okay. Because this is the nature of man. Man is quarrelsome. Man would always lust for power, desire power, okay? We need the state for order and security, okay? So, under the force theory, physically strong men would attack, capture, enslaved weak men, okay? So, the powerful man would first exercise his authority over a number of people, and then it will grow to clans, tribes, and then eventually he would rule over a state, right? So For the first theory, power is needed to enforce the law and the will of the sovereign. Okay? Without power, without force, there would be no state, no government, there would be no stability and no security. Okay? So under the first theory, whoever has the power to rule can also claim that they have the authority to rule. Okay? So it under this scenario might makes right. Okay? If you have the power, if you have force, you can use it and you can rule over the people. Okay? So the state was formed due to force that is exerted by the strong over the weak. So war begets the king. Okay? Pag nagkaroon ng war, kakaroon ng king. Alright? So the state came into existence out of conquest, force, or coercion. And before the state existed, there were always leaders strong enough to assert their leadership and power through force, conquest, or violence. They subjected the people and compelled the people to obey their law. Okay? So consequently, these leaders became the seat of sovereign power. Okay? Whoever was the most powerful became the ruler. How about the economic theory? Okay? So, according to the economic theory, the state developed out of man's economic wants. Okay? So, state was formed from the exchange of goods and services. The state was needed to regulate the exchange of goods and services and to supervise the provision of the economic wants and needs of man. Okay? So, for the economic theory, man could not procure all the necessary things that he needed. So we have to associate with other men in order to provide what he needs. Okay? And he would engage in exchange of goods and services. And from that, the state was formed from that relationship. So those are just some of the theories on the origin of the state. Let's go to the objectives of the state, which are also functions of the government. Okay. So first is domestic order and tranquility, or peace. Okay. So the state, through the government, is obligated to maintain peace and order. So how will the state maintain peace and order? Through the legislation and enforcement of laws. Okay, so through laws, we have the police force that would apprehend or capture criminals. And the government would also stop domestic violence. It's one essential function of the government. Okay, we also have our court system that would settle disputes or conflicts among people. Okay, so another objectives of the state and function of the government is the common defense of the state. So the state should defend, okay, its people from external aggression. The state is bound to defend the people from invasion. Okay, so we or governments would undertake measures that would enable them to defend their state from external aggression, like the maintenance of unarmed forces and the maintenance or the development of foreign service relations to promote peaceful relations with other states. Okay, like say, like in the case of the Philippines, of course, we have our own armed forces. However, it's not really strong. It's actually weak if you compare it to the armed forces of other states. So, in this instance, other states, other strong states can just invade the Philippines and they can actually do it, right? So, with that, we lack in terms of armed forces capability. However, what we are doing is we are developing our foreign relations with other states, okay? Of course, to compensate for what we lack in terms of the armed forces. So, we develop friendly relationships with other states in order to, what? Prevent aggression, okay? And of course, we are also able to get help from other states because of our foreign relations, foreign service relations, okay? Third, blessing of liberty and justice. So the state is obliged to secure and assure liberty and justice for the people. Okay, so the state is there so that the people will have liberty, so that justice is also what given to the people, assured to the people. Okay, number four, promotion of the general welfare. Okay, so the promotion of the general welfare is undertaken by the government by performing functions like what? We have our health services, we have our education services, we have other government, we have government agencies that are catering to the interest of the people. Okay, so it is an essential function of the government to provide the general welfare of the people, provide for the general welfare of the people, to provide public services. Okay, so those are four essential objectives of the state: domestic order and tranquility, defense of the state, ensure liberty and justice to the people, and promote general welfare or provide public services. Let's also take a look at the inherent powers of the state. These are powers that belong to the state. Okay, so taxation. Okay, this is the right of the state or the power of the state to collect, enforce, okay, demand contribution from the people, even from the property of the people. The state have the power to raise revenue. Okay. Why do we have to collect from the people? Why do we have taxation? Okay, this is important to fund the expenses of the state. Okay, the tax that is being collected from the people is the blood that makes the state runs. Okay, so the power of taxation is necessary in order to support the operations of the government. So we would collect contribution from the people, we would enforce tax from properties, corporations, okay? We have income tax, we have value-added tax, all kinds of tax that we have now to support the operations of the government so that we can provide public services to the people, okay? So the state class cannot continue to operate or exist without financial means. That is why it has the power of taxation. Okay? Soon, when you have your jobs after graduation, you will feel, okay, you will feel the burden of taxation. You are giving a portion of your salary to the government because it's your duty as a citizen, and the state has the power to collect from you. Next, power. Power of eminent domain. Okay, so this is the power of the state to take a private property for public use upon payment of just compensation. Okay, so when it is a public necessity to take a private property, when it is necessary, like we need to build a road going to somewhere and madadaanan yung bahay ni Juan, okay, then the state have the power to take the property of Juan. Okay, however, the state needs to pay Juan. Okay, hindi pwedeng lugi. Okay, just compensation. That is the power of eminent domain. It is the power of the state to take a private property for public use, and a private citizen or a citizen cannot say no. Okay, the state can take it forcibly, right? But of course, it has to give just payment or just compensation. Okay. Third is police power. When we say police power, it is the state's power to promote the public welfare, peace and order, okay, by restraining and regulating the use of liberty and property of all the people. Okay, so police power class would permit the state to take liberty, property, or even the life of a person for the better good of the society as a whole. So those are the three powers, inherent powers of the state. Okay, police power, eminent domain, and what's the other one? Taxation. Now, class, let's take a look at the difference between a state and a nation. They're not the same, okay? Although, again, they're being used interchangeably, just like government and state. But a state and a nation are different, okay? So, a state is a political concept, right? So, again, it exists as long as the four elements are intact. Okay. However, a nation is an ethnic concept. Okay. So, a nation class is a group of people who have common culture, common habits, common traditions. They also have common desire to live together as a separate group. Okay. They have a well-defined loyalties and objectives. So, even if some of the essential elements of a nation may not be present, even if they only have common tradition, okay, but they don't have a common objective, they can still be called a nation, okay? Even if they don't have a common religion or a common culture, but they are united as one people, okay, as a group, even if they don't have a state, they can still be considered as a nation, okay? Although they do not form a state. This, a nation is a group of people who have commonality, okay? It's not fixed. They don't necessarily need to have a common tradition, common loyalty, common objective, or a common custom for them to exist, okay? Unlike a state, a state has to have the four elements intact, okay? An example is Israel, okay? So, in spite of Israel's internal factions, there are a lot of groups in Israel with varying origins, sometimes conflicting ideas, okay? But they are united when it comes to preserving the security of the state, okay? So, They are determined to survive as a state, okay? They are determined to maintain their homeland, okay? Since they are what surrounded by their enemies, okay? They're the only Jewish state, okay? And they are surrounded by what Muslim countries. So although they do not have common habits, okay, but they have common objectives, they are still considered as a nation, okay, just like the Palestinian people. You can consider them as a nation even if they don't have a government, because they have a commonality that is binding them together, okay? So that's how you differentiate a state versus a nation. A nation is a group of people that has commonality, okay? While a state, okay, is a political entity that is composed of people, territory, government, and sovereignty, okay? So if you have questions, guys, just send me a message and I'll be glad to answer them for you.